The scripture text for this edition of Dr. Barnhouse and the Bible, Romans chapter 8 and verse 14. Here again is Dr. Donald Gray Barnhouse with a message entitled, Sons of God.
Through the Lord Jesus Christ we come unto thee, our Father and our God, and in the Holy Spirit. Thou hast loved us, and in the fullness of time thou hast come in Jesus Christ to redeem us by thy grace, and hast made us to become thy sons through him. Bless us in this hour, and use thy word to thine honor and glory, that we may be strengthened in thee. We ask it in the name and for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We're studying together in the 8th chapter of Romans, and in the 14th verse we read, As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. They are the sons of God. John, in his first epistle, says, Consider the incredible love that the Father has shown us in allowing us to be called children of God. And that is not just what we are called, but what we are. Our heredity on the Godward side is no mere figure of speech, which explains why the world will no more recognize us than it recognized Christ. For we have been given the authority to be called the sons of God, an authority which has been withheld from the angels and given only to us. For we read in Hebrews 1, For unto which of the angels said he at any time, Thou art my son? But to every poor sinner who comes unto God through the Lord Jesus Christ, the eternal Creator says no less than this, Thou art my son. He brought us out of death and into life by regenerating us. We were always his subjects because he had created us and we were part of his kingdom. But we have been translated out of darkness into light and are now sons of God through his grace. Now it's always God's method to give us great blessing and then call upon us to live in the light of that blessing. God never demands anything of us that he has not already provided for us. So he tells us that this relationship and all that is involved is not something that is for the far future, but something that is ours in this present instant. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. This sonship is ours right now, is mine right now. And its actuality is one of the great impulsions for me to live a life of holiness, yielded unto the Father. It is on the basis of our present sonship that Paul tells the Ephesian Christians that they should act as children act the world over. Anyone who has ever watched small children knows that they imitate their elders to an extraordinary degree. Our old version says, Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. But all of the revisions change the word to the true translation from the Greek and tell us that we are to be imitators of God, as children who are beloved by him. Phillips paraphrases it, As children copy their fathers, you, as God's children, are to copy him. I remember a story which I heard years ago of a man who had a small child who wanted to do everything that the father did. One New Year's Day, the father took the son with him while he made the rounds of the homes of several of his friends. At each of these homes, there was the punch bowl, and the father drank too much in celebrating the New Year. As they were going home, they crossed a park. The father turned around to see whether his son was near at hand, and saw him at a distance, taking great steps in order to put his feet squarely in the prints which the father had left in the snow. The boy saw his father stop and turn, and called out, Daddy, I'm putting my feet right in your footsteps. The father saw that he had not left a very straight track, and it sobered him immediately, and he resolved never to take again that which would cause his own son to go astray. Children do copy their fathers. It is this trait in children which God brings before us and urges us to practice in our relationship to him. It is because we are his children that we are to seek to imitate him. The world should recognize that we are his because they see him in us. There is a phrase that started as a mispronunciation in dialectical English to describe the resemblance of a child for one of the parents. It came into more formal usage a little over 100 years ago in a phrase, the child is the very spitten image of his father. Now it was the faulty reproduction by an untutored mind who passed a better phrase on in that form. For originally the words set forth that the child was the very spirit and image of the Father. The very spirit and image of the Father. That is what we should be of our heavenly Father. For there is evidence that we are not only children, but we are wanted and planned children of our God. We are told that He hath chosen us in Christ before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He has made us accepted in the Beloved. That's Ephesians 1, 5 and 6. We are a planned family. Now, a planned family is a wonderful thing. It gives the children a sense of security to know that they were wanted, earnestly desired, and that life was built around their coming. When I was first married many years ago, we chose the names for our first four children almost at once. We prayed for them daily, years before they were born. We asked the Lord for a girl first and last, with two boys in between, because we wanted the feminine influence in the home as early and late as possible. And there never was a day that we did not pray at family worship for Ruth, Donald, David, and Dorothy. When the first child was about three, and the second child had just come, she asked one day when the others were to come. There had never been a day in her childish prayers that her brothers and sister had not been mentioned. Now, I'm sure that one factor in the good integration of their childish personalities was the unconscious feeling that they were wanted, that they were at the very center of the home and all its life, and that there was nothing around them but the security of love. I know from memories of my own childhood that it was the same thing. Sacrifices were expected and accepted because the desired children were to be the very life of that home. Now, spiritually, we have that same assurance from our God. Before the foundation of the world, the Heavenly Father planned that we should be, chose us in Christ in the counsels of eternity, bringing it all to pass according to the counsel of His own good pleasure. Now we shall see this more fully when we come to another statement of this phase of our eternal predestination, later in this chapter, in the 29th verse, where it says that we were thus chosen in order that we might be conformed to the image of His Son. There are many verses in the Scripture which expand the question of our sonship and show its nature and the claims of our position upon us. We're told by Peter that we have been given exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we might be made partakers of the divine nature. This means that we have been made anew in the likeness of our Lord. The image that was lost in the fall is regained in our redemption and regeneration. This involves our oneness with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Spiritually speaking, it is our sonship that draws us to the Father in prayer and in reliance upon Him for the fulfillment of all our needs. When a child is small, it comes to the Father for all its little needs and for the tenderness of the affection which is its great need. See the Father come home from the day's work. The children are awaiting His return. They run to meet Him. He takes them to His arms and carries them the last short distance to the house. The baby toddles ecstatically across the garden walk to meet Him. All together, they are in one joyous embrace. Hearts are full to overflowing. All this is to be found in our relationship as sons to the Father. The child moans restlessly in its cot. Fever has stricken it down. The father places his hand upon the head, and the child whispers from its parched throat, "Daddy." There is all this to be found in our relationship as sons with the Father. The girl or the boy of teenage comes home with the consciousness of some great disgrace. "I didn't mean to do it, Daddy." The father's arms are open, and their tears are mingled together. And all that is to be found in our relationship as sons with the Father. Do you see that handsome man of 50 meet that splendid youngster of 22 who has just won honors in his college? The father grips the boy's arm and feels the strong muscles flex beneath his touch. Strong glance meets strong glance. "Fine work, my boy," says the father. "Oh, forget it, Dad," says the son. Their glances meet again. They have both recognized that there is something new between them. The boy is admitted to a new place in the mind of the father. He has come into the ranks of manhood. A wise son maketh a glad father, we read in Proverbs 10:1. And all this is involved in our relationship with the Heavenly Father as His sons through Christ Jesus. Our infant hearts smile toward His familiar face. Our fevered hearts repeat His name. Our sinful prodigal souls grope their way back to Him, to find Him ever waiting with the robe, the ring, and the kiss. The strongest efforts of our yielded spirits, building upon His firm word and in His strength, meet the steady gaze of His holiness, and turn back all the praise and the glory to Him. It is the Holy Spirit making our sonship surge with realness that thus draws us in all of our feelings out towards the one whom we have learned to know as Father, because He has eternally chosen us as sons and has planned for us to become His sons. Truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. Now, our position as the sons of God also involves a magnificent dignity. Right away, let me say that when I speak of our dignity as sons of God, I'm not thinking of any of the stuffiness that has so often masqueraded as piety and paraded pompously as real worth. Rather, am I thinking of those obligations which are conferred upon us by the relationship to which our God has begotten us. If the feudal lords thought that their position of aristocracy placed upon them the obligation of nobility, how much more shall we realize that the supernatural aristocracy of our more than noble birth, yes, of our divine birth, brings with it the constraining obligations of a high walk, a holy walk, and a heavenly walk with our God. It is on this ground that the apostle pleads over and over again that believers shall walk worthily of the calling wherewith they are called, to walk worthily of the Lord unto all well-pleasing. It is on this high ground that we are moved by the love of Christ which constraineth us, that we are brought to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. It is this relationship as sons which draws us out in reverent prayer. When the Lord told His disciples to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven," He added that we were to continue saying, "Hallowed be Thy name." And surely one of the most hallowed of all the names of our God is that by which we come to Him most tenderly, calling Him our Father. I cannot understand the lightness in spiritual things. I cannot understand the mentality that will laugh and joke in spiritual matters, that will stoop to crass methods in a religious service, or that will debase the worship of the living God our Father with that which is cheap and tawdry. For surely, as princes of the royal blood, we will recognize the supreme honor of our Heavenly Father, and this will cause us to approach Him in spirit and in truth, as He seeks such to worship Him. Further, a consciousness of the divine relationship should arouse in us every feeling of love and confidence and obedience. We should delight to do His will, even as the Lord Jesus came to do His Father's will. The Lord spoke a parable of two sons, both of whom received a command of their father to go forth and work in His vineyard. One of them immediately acknowledged his readiness to perform the obligation and went out and forgot all about it. The other one announced his refusal to obey, but went out and accomplished that which he had been told to do. The Lord asked which one of these had done the will of the Father and received the answer that it was the son who really did the thing he had been told to do. It would have been still better, of course, if the third son had been there to say that he would certainly do what he was told to do and then had gone and done it. It is such a relationship that we should seek to have towards our Heavenly Father as those whom He has chosen as sons. We're allowed to realize also that our place as sons of God guarantees to us certain rights from God. Earthly law acknowledges the obligations of a father to care for his children. Our God has also expressed the divine principle that He is responsible for our care and keeping. He has set forth the rule that the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. We read that in 2 Corinthians 12:14. Now, if this is true on the human level, can we think even for a moment that the Heavenly Father will not conform to His own divine laws? Our Savior pointed out that the Lord God took care of the grass of the fields and of the birds of the air, and that there was not one sparrow that could fall without the knowledge of our Father. Sometimes it helps to put old, well-known phrases into entirely new speech. Listen to this truth from the Sermon on the Mount, set forth in a combination of two modern versions. I have blended Weymouth and Phillips to make one paragraph to shine forth with greater brilliance. Don't worry about living, Christ said. Don't worry about living, wondering what you're going to eat or drink or what you're going to wear. Surely life is more important than food and the body more important than the clothes you wear. Look at the birds in the sky. They do not sow or reap or store up in barns, but your Heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you much more valuable to Him than they? Can any of you, no matter how much he worries, make himself a foot taller? Consider well the wild lilies, how they grow. They neither work nor weave, but I tell you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now, if God gives such clothes to the flowers of the field, which are alive today and burnt in the stove tomorrow, is he not much more likely to clothe you, you little faiths? So don't worry and don't keep saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? That is what pagans are always looking for. Your Heavenly Father knows that you need them all. Set your heart on His kingdom and righteousness, and all these things will come unto you as a matter of course. Don't worry at all then about tomorrow. Tomorrow can take care of itself. One day's trouble is enough for one day. Someone has said that God will never break His own law. Our Father's parental care and love, all that His wisdom can devise, all that His power can reach, all that His resources can supply, is secured to His children, or else He would not be the Father He professes to be. Is He my Father? Then He will supply all my need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Is He my Father? Then neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creation shall be able to separate me from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Is He my Father? Then He is ready to forgive. The prodigal son carefully rehearsed the speech which he planned to speak upon his arrival home. We can hear him walking down the road. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no longer worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. I'll arise and go to my father, and I will say. And he began to count off the phrases which he would utter when he reached home. But the father saw him when he was afar off, and ran to meet him. Compare in Luke 15, compare what the prodigal planned to say with what he actually got said. He spoke to his father and said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no longer worthy to be called thy son. It was at that point that his father stopped his mouth with a kiss, and the son was never permitted to demean himself by saying what he had announced that he would say, make me as one of thy hired servants. A hired servant? Never. We are sons. Is he my father? Then the angel of the Lord encampeth round about me, and I am kept by the power of God through faith unto the completion of my salvation in heaven. Is he my father? Then he will teach me the lessons I need to learn, and discipline me in the school by which I shall be educated for heaven. There may be lessons hard for flesh and blood to learn, but patiently and tenderly, his own Holy Spirit shall teach them. Nor will he, when necessary, spare the rod and spoil his child. For whom the Lord loves, he disciplines and scourges every son whom he receives. And while we are being trained and fitted for the position he intends us to occupy, nothing shall interfere with the purpose in Christ concerning us. For he is daily conforming us to the image of his Son. This is his eternal purpose, and the time shall come when we shall see him and be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Oh, what a noble company we belong to. The eternally chosen brotherhood of those who have been redeemed out of this world by the blood of the Savior and brought into the family of God through regeneration. One of the marks of our sonship is that we shall recognize other members of our family in the midst of a world largely composed of children of wrath and children of disobedience. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. Here is the true ecumenism. The nearer I grow to Christ, the more I wish to have fellowship with all those who truly believe in Him, in His person, and in His work. I am a son of God, in the singular, but we are sons of God in the plural. We were not meant to live isolated lives. Like must seek like. I must find myself drawn to those who also love the Lord and wish to honor Him. I have been greatly disturbed in recent years at the tendency of some fundamental believers to draw off in a corner and to divorce from their fellowship everyone who did not cross the T's at the same angle that they crossed them. I have been disturbed at the fact that some people have been guilty of separation from other Christians because they considered them not quite as separated as they were themselves. Now this thought on the true ecumenism is so important that we shall, the Lord willing, spend our next study on this subject. And our God and Father, we pray Thee that the Holy Spirit shall bless this truth to every heart in this hour. We thank Thee that Thou hast made us to be sons, children of God, O glorious calling. Surely His grace will keep us from falling, passing from death to life at His call. Blessed salvation, once for all. And our God and Father, we pray that if there be any who listen who have not been born again and who are not therefore Thy true sons, that Thou shalt give them restlessness until they come to rest in Christ. But upon all Thy redeemed own, may Thy grace, Thy mercy, and Thy peace abide, and a new sense of our sonship and our oneness in Christ. And unto Thee be the glory and the majesty, the dominion and the power, now, till our Lord Jesus come again and forever. Amen.